Hello and welcome to this virtual tour of the exhibition The World Is In You. My name is Jacob Lillemose and I'm one of the four curators of the exhibition. We're standing here at the Kunsthal Charlottenborg, but the show is curated by another institution, namely the Medical Museion, which is just down the road. The Medical Museion is the Copenhagen University's museum for the history of medicine, cultural history, scientific history of medicine, and we have joined forces with Kunsthal Charlottenborg to put on this show that we will now give you a short introduction to, show you some of the works, tell you a little bit about what the show is about. The title, The World Is In You, is quite literal in the sense that the show is looking at the question of how the environment that our bodies inhabit influence our bodies, how they change our bodies in various ways. And in a way you can say that this question was inspired by another question that is very much occupying the present time, namely, what do we do to the world? And we wanted to reverse that question and instead take a look at this question from the other side, from what the body does to us, and in that way create another aspect of this environmental awareness of what it means to be a body in the world, and also to point out that the influence goes both ways. So what we will see now in the next half an hour or so is a show that consists of science, of art, of cultural artifacts that all in various ways deal with this. The show is structured around four themes. One is called generations, another one is microbes, space and time, and we'll go through all these sections and look at the various objects that are in these sections to give you an idea of what we actually mean with this idea of the world is in you. Let's start down here with actually one of the very first objects that we collected. These are objects that we have from our own collection at the Medical Museion, and they are various objects that have been extracted from the throats of people. So as you can see, these are household objects, bones from chickens and fish, buttons of various kinds that people have had in their mouth and then accidentally swallowed as they were doing their daily jobs. And I think this piece or these artifacts are really interesting in the sense that they show that when we talk about the body, the world is in you, we are also talking about a very kind of concrete way of looking at it. It is about how the world is in you in everyday life. And of course, it also shows that that the world is in you is not only a good thing. Sometimes the fact that the world is in you is something that you need to get the world out of the body again. And on a further level, that poses the question of what part of the world do we get in our bodies? And that's a larger social, political aspect of the show in the sense that we don't all get the same parts of the world into our bodies. And in that way, the theme is also kind of open to sort of differences in around the world. What kind of world is it that people actually get in them? But if we look at this concrete, let me take you over to a more abstract object, it's a very concrete object, but an object that thematizes the show theme in a very in a more abstract way. What we're looking at here is a piece of iron meteorite. It's 4.6 billion years old, so it was created when the solar system was created. And the reason why we put this into the show is to say, okay, all the major ingredients of the human body were actually formed when the solar system was created. So in a way, this idea of stardust, that we all created by stardust, actually holds a true literal meaning. And I think in between this piece of very, very old rock and everyday objects over here, you get an idea of the span that the exhibition The World in You operates in. It's a very large scope. It's from the microbial world, the very, very small world, to the very, very large horizons of the universe. And please come with me as we travel further into this to this world. We could actually start here with an artistic piece that we commissioned for the work by the UK artist Anna Demetriou. And on the face of it, it looks like an ordinary, kind of maybe historical cabinet of medicine, but it's actually an artwork that Anna Demetriou developed for the show, containing various kinds of imagined medicine for what she calls the post-pandemic body. What you find in this cabinet is some of it beyond belief, some of it may be plausible, some of it is absolutely fake. But just to give you an example, what is in here, we have pills that contains DNA from small organisms, microorganisms that are resistant to radioactivity. So in the case that you were to be exposed to a high degree of radioactivity, maybe these pills could help you. So in a way of taking the body into yourself could protect you from the body, or from the world that is that could be poisonous. There's all sorts of different other medicines. There is pills with inactive tuberculosis DNA that plays on this fact that tuberculosis has been a predominant illness within the history of creativity, and especially with a lot of writers, and so on and so forth. So it's a piece of work that plays with how medicine is both science, because these pills were actually developed through scientific methods, and it's also a work of the imagination. And I think that goes for the whole show. It has two tracks that overlaps in various ways, the work of science and the work of the imagination. And what brings these two tracks together is that they're both explorative. They look at a world with wonder, with curiosity, and then try to kind of ask the questions that we don't know the answers to yet. Come with me and we'll take the first theme down here. This is the theme of time, and it looks at what is called the scientific discipline of chronobiology, that looks at how the body has basically a circadian rhythm, and how this circadian rhythm is influenced in various ways. If we start over here, we have a banner that we borrow from the Workers' Museum in Copenhagen. It says 8 hours of work, 8 hours of freedom, and 8 hours of rest. And what this banner shows is that the human body doesn't not only have a circadian rhythm, it also has a work rhythm. And the idea of a work rhythm becomes even more pronounced in this work by Revita Lacone and Tor van Baalen. It's a stage video work called 75 watts, referring to the fact that early in the industrial age, there was this idea that one worker in one day's of work could produce 75 watts worth of work. And what we have here is a number of workers in this factory in China producing this weird contemporary digital object. And the work shows how this body is being choreographed by modern workforce, or modern work logic, and plays kind of with the absurdity of how this body is structured. If you follow me here, you have here another example of how the body and the clock is playing against each other. This is a work by artist Marcus Coates, and the work is pretty much what you see. It's the artist moving the clock of this watch for 12 hours straight. In a way, you could say this is a embodiment of the enslavement of the body to the clock time, to work time. And I think it probably also started out that way for the artist, but what happened as he continued with this endurance performance was that he became one with time, and to the point that he, at the end, actually felt like he was the one moving time, and was afraid to stop, because if he would stop, then he was afraid that time would actually stop. If we continue over here, I think I will show you this precious little painting from one of the main tourist attractions in Copenhagen. It's a painting from 1910 by Danish painter Paul Fischer, and it shows the amusement park Tivoli at night. And why is this painting in the show? Well, Tivoli was the first example of what you will now know as light pollution in Denmark. Of course, it's commonly known as a place for recreational activities, and people were marveled by these evening lights. But at the same time, Tivoli also became a first expression of how our cities are becoming more and more polluted by light, or in the sense that they don't follow the normal light and dark rhythms anymore. Of course, for people, this might not be a problem, but the idea was that, okay, what happens to all the animal life in the city that all of a sudden has this extreme amount of light during the night? Will that disturb their circadian rhythm? And of course, this idea is now also an issue for humans that live in cities where you basically have lights 24/7. And if we turn around here, you will see something that is, on the face of it, looks like an abstract painting. And in a way, it is also an abstract painting. Well, actually, it's a tapestry by a British artist, Susan Morris, who for 3 years had a watch that registered the light environment she was in at any given time. And then it transferred that data to a weave that would then make this tapestry. So what you see here is the light and dark environment that Susan Morris inhabited for 3 years, with day and night, summer, winter, fall, over the course of the year. And I think what's beautiful about this image is that it shows that that light and dark is actually an environment that embraces our body all the time. Depending on where you live in the world, this light and dark tapestry would look very different. Had she lived in Iceland, for example, it would have been a different tapestry. Let's continue. Now we will take you from time into space. And space is interesting in the context of the world is in you, because space is radical in the sense that it takes the body out of the environment that it has been accustomed to or adapted to over thousands and thousands of years. So what happens to the body when you take it out of its natural environment? That's maybe not the question that space medicine or the general public thinks about space travel, but actually getting the body into space is maybe the biggest issue. It's not so much the technological aspect of making rockets and so forth, and that we have solved that, but actually how to get the body into space is still a question that poses a lot of challenges. One way of trying to deal with this is this work by Austrian artist Rallo Meyer, that was also commissioned for the exhibition. It's called Unearthing Pharmacon, and it shows the artist in partly in a video and partly in this installation. And in the video, you see the artist in various intimate relations with pieces of meteorite, putting them on his eyes, on his tongue, basically being intimate with them on his body. And in a way, you can look at this video as a way of trying to get to know the universe like a child gets to know the world, basically by touching it. How can we grasp our connection to this huge, huge space? Maybe touching it in this intimate way is one way. Another way that that this little installation also suggests is putting it inside our body in a very literal way. What we see here is the remedies of a scientist, a fictive scientist, who for this exhibition collaborated, or actually the artist did collaborate with a pharmaceutical laboratory at the University of Vienna to produce these fizzy tablets that contains moon dust, asteroid dust, and Mars dust. And then the idea is, if we need to adapt the space or prepare the body to go into space, then maybe it could be an idea to take some of that environment into our bodies. If we continue, I want to show you this little object. It's a curious object that was actually at the International Space Station. It's a measuring device developed by a Danish company called Danish Aerospace Company. And what it does, it measures the inhalation and exhalation of astronauts. And that is important because when you're at ISS, you're in a space with no gravity, and that means that dust does not fall onto surfaces. So there's a lot of dust in the air, and that means that you potentially inhale quite a lot of dust that could lead to inflammation of the lungs. So it's really important to check that regularly to see if the lungs are coping okay with the amount of dust that is being inhaled. Let's continue and see another example of how space influences our body. What we see here are two videos. They are videos of the hearts of fruit flies. And why have we included those in the exhibitions? Well, first of all, fruit flies were the first organisms from Earth that traveled into space back in 1947 on a V2 rocket. And the reason why fruit flies are used in space research and space medicine is because we actually share 75% genetic material with fruit flies. So there is a possibility to look at what fruit flies, how fruit flies are affected by space, and then compare to get an idea of how it could influence the human body. What we see here is recordings of fruit fly hearts. One fruit fly heart, the one on the left, is from a fruit fly heart that has been into space, and the other one is from a fruit fly heart that has not been to space. And basically what we see is that the effect is that the fruit fly who has been to space has a much more irregular heartbeat. The way fruit flies are used is that you could say that one day in space for a fruit fly compares to 1 year in space for a human being. And that means you could actually get ideas of how the long-term effects of space travel on the human body, what those are. And that is the main question right now if we want to go to planets further away, such as Mars. Another example of of a way to adapt to a foreign environment is this project by the Mediated Matter Group and Neri Oxman. It's called Wanderers, and it's basically a series of spacesuits. Well, they don't look like spacesuits, at least not the traditional spacesuits, but these are 3D printed models that incorporate synthetic produced microorganisms that each of them make the uninhabitable parts of a given environment that's in certain planetary environments habitable. So while traditional spacesuits work to protect your body from the environment, this project plays with the idea that the spacesuit should actually integrate you into the environment of the foreign and alien environment on different planets. And then we turn to this piece over here. It's another piece by Ralo Meyer, who we just saw working with the pharma project in the other room. What you see here is it's a kid's play suit. And why do we have that here? Well, we have it here because we wanted to pose the question of what will a future life of not only humans but families look and like on Mars. One thing that's for sure is that the kids need a warm suit, maybe probably warmer than the one you see lying on the floor here. But further, this work also raises the question, what will it be like to raise kids on Mars, both practically and physically? And even maybe before we ask that question, we can ask, is it even possible to raise kids on Mars and to give birth to kids on Mars? And that's a question that will remain unanswered until we actually try. And why it's such an important question is, when there's no gravity, all the fluids in our bodies don't react like they used to. And giving birth or becoming pregnant and giving birth to a child involves a lot of fluids. And if those fluids don't flow like they are used to, then the question is, what happens then? Please join me to the next room, where we see a huge globe worked by British artist Luke Jerram called Gaia. It was produced on the 50th anniversary of the moon landing, and the size of the globe is determined by, if you stand at a certain distance from this globe, it has the same size as the Earth would have if you stand on the moon. In the context of The World Is In You, we thought it would be an amazing object for people to see in this space as a way to relate it to their own bodies. Because when we say the world is in you, this is of course the world we mean. This is the world that determines this body that we have. This is the world that has shaped our bodies. And we wanted to have people look at this world, and also maybe return to the question that I started out with, this idea that the world is in you is another way of asking the question of what we are doing to the world, by reversing that question to what is the world doing to us, but also pointing out that those two questions are super entangled. You cannot have the one question without the other. Now we move from the large, from the macrocosmic scale to the microcosmic scale, and we'll go into the next theme. We'll come in through the back, so to speak. This is the theme of microbes, and we'll start with this piece by South Korean artist Jiwon Woo, and it's called Mother's Hand Taste, or Sun Mat, which is a concept that is common in Korean cooking. And the work consists of research that the artist did with for four families and three generations of women who were cooking this traditional Korean rice drink. And she was looking at how the microorganisms from the hands of the cookers were passed on through generations. So this idea that the person that makes the food not only follows has a certain recipe, but actually the microbiome on her on her hands contributes to the taste of the food, and especially in this Korean food, which is fermented food. So there was a very scientific approach, and then she, in relation to that, produced this kind of kitchen equipment that is able to extract the taste of the hand, and then you are able to put it into a food. So you can actually take the food, the taste of someone's hands, and put it into your own food. The work is also interesting in the sense that it shows how bacteria and microbiomes are not only biological entities, but they are actually part of creating cultures. They're taking part in creating cultures and creating social relations. If you follow me here, we'll get into another aspect of microbes, and it's called hygiene, this section. And of course, I think the last 2 years have taught us a lot about hygiene and how we should get rid of bacteria. But if you turn around, we'll show you a work that kind of complicates that question a little bit. This is a work by American artist Kathy High, where she grew her microbiome and fellow researchers' biome in this petri dish. And on the one side, if you can see all the six images, you can see in all the six images there's a lot of activity in one side of the dish and not activity in the other side of the dish. And the reason why is that Kathy High suffers from this inflammation called Crohn's disease, a permanent inflammation in the colon, and that the effect of that is that there's basically no life in her intestines. So instead of in this case, the disease is actually visualized through the absence of bacteria, and the healthy person has a rich, a lively bacteria inside of the intestine. So it also points to this way that our inside, the world is in you, is basically that we have a world in us. We have millions and billions of bacteria living inside us on our skin and in the environment around us. And the question is then, how much do they define who we are? That's something that science is very much interested in finding out. And I think it'll be one of the questions that will be on the forefront of scientific research in the coming years. Let's go to the last section. That's the section called generations, looking at epigenetics. We'll start with this little intro object, a flask that contains a liquid that, well, you can't smell it, but I can smell it, and I can tell you that it smells a little bit like cherry, like in cherry coke or almond. And the reason why we have this object here is it relates to experiment from 2013, where laboratory mice, male laboratory mice, was exposed to this smell and then combined with a little electroshock. And then those male mice were bred on, and their offspring were separated from them. And what was curious was that in two generations after the offspring, who had no contact with their fathers and grandfathers, still had a negative reaction when they smelled this, when they were exposed to this smell. So that says something about that what we experience is not only something that we pass on through cultural narration, but something that actually inhabits our body or affects us on a molecular level. And another example of this, if we continue here, is this is archival material from what is called the Dutch hunger winter, and relates to the winter of 1944 and 1945, where the Germans cut off half of Holland, and there was a hunger in that one half of Holland. And researchers then looked at the kids of the women who were pregnant during this hunger, and what they found out that there was a higher occurrence or frequency of diabetes and eating disorders with these kids, but also schizophrenia. So it says something about that the food we eat is more than just energy. It's actually an environment. It's a very fundamental experience that shapes us in ways that not only are physical but also mental. We continue in the generation sections, almost at the end of the show, with a series of photographs by American artist Kathleen Riddell, and it shows parenting. It's in all its beauty and and horror, if you will. But no, it looks. These are three photographs where the artist has disguised herself as a giant bunny rabbit, as a kitchen table, and as a chair, and it looks at how parenting is basically an environment of care, and how you as a parent also can disappear into this environment and feel like you're not really there because you're basically just a service function. But at the same time, these are also very caring photos of the parent being close to the kid, and how and talks to the importance of this intimacy with the kid. Let's finish off. Let's finish off with this last section of the generation. It's called Toxic Worlds, and looks at how pollution has affected the body. And of course, this comes back to this idea of what we are doing to the world is also something that then comes back to us. And a very good example of that is this DDT spray from the 1950s that we are exhibiting. DDT was invented to kill insects that carried malaria, but unfortunately they didn't only kill malaria, they also seeped into the environment and had horrible effects, caused especially liver cancer in human beings, and eventually was abandoned. So it's this idea that how what we put into the world will eventually come back to us. There's no outside of the world. Whatever we do in the world becomes part of the world and then becomes part of us. I think that's a good place to stop. I hope you've enjoyed this little tour. The show closes tomorrow, unfortunately, a little bit before time due to COVID restrictions. But later this year, we will have a website up at the Medical Museion web homepage where you can see the show in more elaborate forms, interviews with the curators, interviews with some of the artists. So please check the Medical Museion website later this year for more information or an expanded virtual showing of the exhibition. Thank you.